welcome to another episode of Journey of the Rush. My name is Andreas Sachenk, and this is...
I don't really want to do it this week.
You don't feel like doing an episode this week?
I don't feel like doing it, man.
Well, I'm afraid you're suspended for two more videos then, Steve.
But then I'm not doing it for two more videos.
You're right.
CHL logic.
Breaking down the law.
We're gonna start by talking about some of the negative things from this past week, but trust me, there's a ton of good stuff coming after. That being said, our first story this week, the CHL chose to suspend Nail Yakupov for not giving me a hat.
This is so not why he got suspended.
It's probably why he got suspended.
Are you happy now?
I don't want your dirty hat.
So last week in Kelowna, BC, there was a CHL Top Prospects game. I'm sorry, are you going to wear it like this all episode long?
Yep.
Okay. And Nail Yakupov said, yeah, I don't want to go.
It's just weird because you know what team he plays for? It's a team on my hat.
Why do I have to bring this up?
My hat.
As you all know, Nail Yakupov severely injured his knee back in January at the World Juniors in the final game against Sweden. He missed a ton of games for the Sarnes team, then got back on the ice, played a few games, and then he had to go to Kelowna, and he didn't want to. So the commissioner of the CHL, David Branch, said, yeah, I'm not okay with that. Suspension, two games. And then he said, well, Mikhail Grigorenko also got injured at the World Juniors, but he came.
Which is basically like saying, well, Johnny jumped off a bridge, so you have to as well.
Johnny. Very Russian name.
Yes, indeed.
But then, of course, the head coach and the GM of the Quebec Ramparts, Patrick Roy, said, yeah, you forced Mikhail to go, you asshole.
Yeah, that does sound just like Patrick Roy.
And illogically enough, Patrick Roy wasn't suspended for saying this, but he was fined for $5,000.
Now, Dave Branch has often been commended for being a commissioner that, you know, kind of thinks outside of the box and is willing to do things that others aren't able to do. But this is just a poor decision. Yakupov is very likely to go first overall, or at least, like, top three, safe bet. So why play an extra game and possibly get hurt? For example, in John Tavares' draft year in 2009, he was also very likely to go first overall, but he played in the top prospects game. What happened, though, is big, giant forward Zach Cassian, it also happened to be his draft year, leveled him into the boards, and he basically separated his shoulder. I know, because I wanted an interview with him after the game, and they're like, nah, bro, his shoulder's broke.
Did it say like that?
No, not really. But, segue coming, you know who I did get to interview instead?
Who?
Braden Shen.
Wait, you didn't just make this up so we could talk about his fight against Kovalchuk.
No, I legitimately interviewed Braden Shen.
But we're still gonna talk about his fight against Kovalchuk.
Okay, fine.
Congratulations to that for knocking the Rocky out.
Braden Shen doesn't know the leg strength of Ilya Kovalchuk. He's like a power lifter from the waist down, and he's just gonna throw this kid around. And the kid's gonna get up and he's gonna wish he was stayed on the ice. Because here it looks like Shen's gonna be okay, but come right there, the right hand puts Shen back down.
Since you love Kovalchuk so much, which I know you do, Steve, maybe you have some comments about that?
I don't really have a problem with the fight because, I mean, Braden Shen challenged him. Kovalchuk was just taking him up. But you know, I just don't really like Kovalchuk as a player. Like, he fought Mike Comrie, who's like 5'9". He almost broke Pavel Kabina's neck. He's done a lot of dirty things. The point at Crosby. And then holding out on the Thrashers.
Scoring again, winning goal against Canada in 2008.
I'm not done. And then asking for the sun, moon, and sky when it came to contract time.
Steve, Kovalchuk is not $100 million, so everybody would like him. Wait a second.
That being said, this fight isn't a great example of why I don't really like Kovalchuk. He was just taking up Braden Shen on the fight, and you know who started all this was Zach Ronaldo.
Since when famous Brazilian soccer players even play hockey?
Well,
Is Roberto Carlos in the NHL too now?
So he was fined $2,500 for two separate incidences, so $5,000. First of all, how does Ronaldo get fined twice in one game and not suspended? And if he wasn't such a cheap little rat in this game, there would have never been a scrum, there would have never been a fight, and his rookie teammate wouldn't have got knocked out.
When since now we're talking about teammates, you know who Alex Radulov wants to be his teammate?
Who?
Vladimir Tarasenko.
Oh.
So recently the news came out that Alex Radulov actually called Tarasenko right before he got traded to SK St. Petersburg and asked him to sign with Tell About Your Life.
That's not fair.
Hello, Volodya?
Yes, this is Volodya.
What do you think about signing with Tell About Your Life and playing with me on the first line along with Igor Grigorenko?
Wow.
So what do you say?
Can you guarantee me you won't hit me in the face with a stick?
I can't give out such guarantees. You know me. Come on.
You know, on second thought, St. Petersburg is beautiful and I like my teeth. Goodbye.
Well, this is just ironic, because a week after Radulov hit his own coach with a stick, he's missing 5 teeth and has 11 stitches. Why? Because this happened.
Опасная игра высоко поднятой клюшкой была со стороны Чурляева.
Ну, вот тут-то я бы не свистел на месте зрителей.
After this incident, Mikhail Chulev, the guy who hit Radulov in the face, got 5+20, which was a good call. However, the KHL is not only about the good calls, it has bad calls as well. For instance, last week, Torpedo's Rocky Finnish forward Kim Hirschrich had a nice spinorama shootout goal.
Pretty sweet.
But it was disallowed. Oh. And I'm pretty sure the ref after that game came home, turned his TV on, and he saw that.
Here he goes! Larzella looking for his fourth, and...
But what really got him thinking is that goal, because it was scored by the same guy.
That goal should have counted.
A little bit, yes.
Now we get to talk about the good stuff.
And first thing on our agenda is Evgeny Timkin's goal. So Vitesse's forward...
Wait, okay, listen, Andre, I know I'm more about the NHL than the KHL, but I'm pretty sure I know enough that there's no way a guy on Vitas did this.
Well, why don't we find out?
Ой-ой-ой-ой, что творит Евгений Тимки?
Show me that again.
Внести в топ-10, но этот гол обязательно в десятке будет, и...
Okay, that was definitely a goal of the year candidate. I have another good goal. It's not quite as good, but it's pretty sweet. From a man with a rough exterior, but silky smooth hands, Todd Bertuzzi.
Players are young and many too young.
A little more grit to their game.
Yeah. Here's Bertuzzi, great move! In a goal! Scores!
He just learned from Datsuk. Okay, so Bertuzzi is trying to beat Timkin's best goal of the year. Let's see if anybody can beat Maxim Sokolov's save of the year.
Смотрим на ворота. Да, Максим Соколов велик.
That was pretty damn good, but J.S. Giguere had something that was just about at that level.
Around the boards, out in the center, Brodziak's got a chance, he's cutting in. Bouncing puck though, look out! Oh my goodness! Wow! Oh man, what a save that was!
You know what their combined age is?
No.
73. I don't know, dude, it kind of feels weird. Was that really play of the week?
Well, there was something else for this guy. I got Sam Gagner, Gagne, not sure. He scored 8 points in a game tying Wayne Gretzky.
Oh, that's
Walcott
right.
Yeah. Actually, speaking of unbelievable scoring achievements, a huge congratulations from Joining the Rush goes out to Scott Gomez, who has now gone over a calendar year without a goal.
So what you're saying is that Sam Gagne got more points in one game than Scott Gomez got in an entire season?
Yes, that is exactly what I'm saying. At the time of his 8-point game, 6,114 players had played in the NHL, not including goalies, and 2,098 of them had failed to score 8 points over their whole career.
Also, as Ryan Whitney, Sam Gagne's teammate, put it on Twitter, scoring 8 points today is like scoring 14 points back in the 80s.
Accurate.
Last but not least, I noticed that this kid is trying to steal our job.
Thicker, girl.
I think it's pretty funny. Why aren't you paying attention, Steve? It's pretty interesting.
That's in Russian. I don't understand it.
It might be your son, actually.
Здорово, с вами я, Саня, и программа «Крутой хоккей». Ребят, спасибо, что вы нас смотрите. Смотрите дальше, мы будем снимать больше.
I swear, it was just one time. I've never been to... This video's over!
Ну что ж, Стив ушел, у меня остается время поговорить немножко по-русски, отвечу, пожалуй, на один из ваших вопросов. Вот тут меня спросили: Андрей, хотелось бы спросить о личной жизни, а с Геббельсом ты как разговариваешь, по-русски или по-английски? Ну, когда приходит Стив, мы с этой дрянью разговариваем, конечно, по-английски. И мне приходится говорить: hey, Геббельс, what's up? Но если Стива нет, то общение, естественно, протекает на великом и могучем. Да, Гебочка, да? Несмотря на немецкое имя и канадское ПМЖ, он называется только на КСКСКС. Well, that's it for this episode of Joining the Russia and All Hockey Dare You. Once again, my name is Andrea Sashenko, and this is...
Not the father!
Yeah, you forced Mikhail to go, you asshole.
Are you gonna put in asshole? You can leave it if you want.
Why not?
Alright, fine. Sorry. At the time of his 8-point game, 6,114 players had played in the NHL, not including goalies, and 2,098 of them had failed to score 8 points over their whole career. Oh, oh shit.
That happens all the time.
It's a pretty bad year. We'll put that in bloopers.